Susan Calman, and I'm a very tense person. Now, a lot of people would probably say that, but let me put that statement into some form of perspective for you. Last week, I was so tense, I found myself getting angry at a pigeon. Because it was taunting me. You see, every time I approached a certain stretch of road near my house, I noticed a pigeon sitting in the middle lane, like a fat, feathery Buddha. I would, of course, slow down and wait for the pigeon to move. After a few encounters, I realised it was the same pigeon every single time. And more than that, he looked me straight in the eye as he strutted away. I was playing a game of chicken with a pigeon. The mind games continued for weeks, same pigeon, same strut, until one day I snapped. I got out of my car, got right up in his face and shouted, "Know what you're doing, mate? Got all the time in the world. You won't win, you know. You won't win." As the pigeon sauntered off, I had to explain to a bus stop full of people that I was simply standing up for myself. I now drive a different route. This angst isn't a recent development. I've always been a tense person, sometimes with long-lasting and devastating consequences for society. When I was younger, I decided I wanted to learn the timpani. If you don't know what that is, it's the giant kettle drum played by the percussionist at the back of an orchestra. I've no real idea why I was determined to play the largest instrument I could find. Perhaps it's the equivalent of men in their cars. I also thought it'd be quite simple, because how hard can it be to twirl some sticks and hit something? The answer is, of course, very hard. It turned out that the key to the timpani was not when you played, but when you didn't. In fact, the majority of time is spent counting bars and waiting for your big moment. Sadly, counting is not one of my skills. And I spent the weeks prior to the school concert sick with nerves, so much so that by the time the night itself arrived, I was barely able to see. I was sweating so much, I looked like a piece of cheese that had been left out in the sun. As you might expect, I lost count after the first minute, panicked, and just started hitting the timpani over and over again, randomly, with no musicality whatsoever. My parents quietly withdrew me from further lessons. The true tragedy of this story is not the fact that the first violin ended up in tears. No, it's that this country was robbed of the next Evelyn Glennie. Events like this dogged me into my adult years, and to be honest, I was strangely proud of myself. I like to think I was quirky, eccentric, if you will. Sadly, it seems that far from being a character in an Amistad Maupin book, I'm actually just a little bit annoying.
I just wish you weren't so tense all the time. It's not endearing to worry about the Christmas driving weather in July.
It's nice, isn't it? It's my wife. Honesty is very important in a relationship, especially towards the end. I knew a change needed to happen, but that caused even more worry because I'm not that good at change. I still call a Snickers a marathon. I still call Sif by its proper name, Jif. And I still open a can of soup the old-fashioned way, even if there's a newfangled ring pool on it. But for the sake of my sanity and my marriage, I knew that change was necessary.
I love you, I love you, I really love you, I love you so much. I just wish you were someone else.
For the purposes of this series, I decided to undertake four activities, each of which have been suggested to help me relax and achieve my aim of ultimate zen. I've asked four friends who claim to find relaxation in an activity that they love to take me along with them and show me how to enjoy it too, against my better judgment. I approached each activity with an open mind, which is a lie, of course I didn't. If I'd wanted to do any of these stupid things, I would have done them years ago. Take the focus of this episode, cricket. Before I get into the meat of the experiment in detail, let me try to explain why cricket does not immediately spring to mind as a relaxing activity for me. Number one, it seems rather, well, English. Now, I hate stereotypes based on nationality. Personally, I've never had a deep-fried Mars bar, nor do I want one. I don't own any albums by Lulu, nor do I want one. And I don't hate the English. For goodness sakes, my sister owns one. So he's married to one. My family is the epitome of cross-border cooperation. And if you can't tell that by looking at us vocally, it's immediately obvious. My niece lives in the East End of London and speaks with a Cockney accent. At 3 years old, she sounds like Dick Van Dyke on helium. Auntie Susan! Auntie Susan! Can we sing Let It Go again? Yes, we can. When you can talk about Scottish history. You know, something from way back, like Bonnie Prince Charlie, or Mary Queen of Scots, or Scottish Labour. Political jibes aside, I'm not in the news quiz now. Let me be clear about my first point. Some people in Scotland play cricket. Some people enjoy cricket. Cricket is not banned on the basis it seems very English. But I think it's fair to say that compared to some other sporting activities in my homeland, it's not the most commonly watched or played. I spoke to a number of friends who find cricket relaxing, and a recurring theme to them was that cricket was the sound of their childhood. Hearing the smack of the ball against the stick immediately made them feel happy and safe, like they were back at their mum and dad's in the long, hot summer months. But these friends were mostly English or Australian. When I asked Scottish friends what they remember of summers, they said the theme tune to Glenn Michael's Cavalcade. And no, I don't care that most of you don't know what that is. Radio 4 is a UK-wide station, and I'm sending that out to the McMassive. Number two, does anything ever happen? I don't know the rules of cricket, but I've never thought that seemed to matter. If I'm honest, in the small doses I've experienced of the game, nothing really seems to happen. For example, in the unfortunate half hour I recall watching, all I saw was a man throwing a ball at another man who kept ducking. Again and again and again. No one else moved on the field. I don't even know if the people on the pitch were meant to be there or if that particular game was just so uneventful spectators could just wander on for a closer look at a man ducking for half an hour. If I had to describe cricket, you know, to an alien who'd just landed on Earth, I'd say, it's a game in which no one scores anything for hours and people don't move. It's like watching a bus queue that happens to be spread out on a field. The problem is that instead of relaxing me, this complete lack of activity makes me feel even more tense. I like things that distract me from everyday worries, that can make me forget all of the other things that make me want to cry on a daily basis. I like sport with passion. The last time I went to see a football match, it was Scotland against Italy. When Scotland scored, a man beside me swept me into his arms and kissed me passionately. And I let him do it. Twice. I can't imagine a stranger trying to snog me because someone bounced a ball and a man ducked. What on earth is the point of a game that goes on for 5 days and no one wins it? How can something go on for so long without a decent conclusion? It's the same feeling I got when I watched the television show Lost. I'm aware of the fact some of you may not get that reference, but I like to reward box set lovers for their long service. Especially those of us who've continued with a show, even when it's long past its best. You know, shows that should have been cancelled years ago, like Heroes, Dexter, and Piers Morgan's life stories. Number three, maths. Cricket seems to me to be a largely arithmetical activity. To put my feelings into an equation, anything plus maths equals minus fun. They're 264 for three after 12 overs. Blah, 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 blah. Hate maths. I just don't see the point in being good at counting. Other people are good at counting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.